Everybody, once again, you're welcome to Encounters with the Holy Spirit. Another encounter with the Holy Spirit. Every day we receive encounters with the Holy Spirit, and the amount of encounters you have with the Holy Spirit, the amount of experiences you have with the Holy Spirit, determines how strong and how bold you are to say, this is what God says I should do. And I am sure, I'm very, very sure about this. So our encounter today is going to be very unique. We're continuing on our topic, the power of his presence. We're going to the part two of it. So before we go into this, I want us to just pray this short prayer. Everlasting King of Glory, we say thank you, God, for your word, oh God. But as we're about to hear your word, Lord Jesus, speak to us in the way only you know how to speak to us. Let us hear you, let us see you through your word, oh God. Father, we cast away every evil presence around us. Father, King of Glory, take charge. Do what you do when you come to a place. Lord Jesus, take charge. And let all glory and adoration return unto you, for in Jesus' most precious name. Hallelujah. So we're in the power of his presence, part two. I remember I stopped yesterday with, until his presence is welcomed, his power will not be manifest in your life. Until you've welcomed his presence into your space, his power will not be manifest in your life. Until God has taken over your place, until you have welcomed him to take over, you're giving him complete access. That's what we mean to welcome somebody. I remember explaining what acknowledging and welcoming means. You acknowledge something, you're saying, I know this person is of good use to me, he's very wonderful, blah blah, but welcoming is that I have acknowledged that you are wonderful, you are powerful, and I'm giving you access to take over, to take charge over everything about me. So I said, until you welcome his presence, his power will not be manifest in your life. And I remember we used the Bible scripture Mark 6:1-5, and we talked about Jesus. Jesus came to his own hometown and he began to preach to them and tell them different great and mighty works, and they were like, wow, this man has intelligence, has knowledge, wisdom, he does miracles, blah blah blah. But at the point, I said, but is this not the carpenter? Is this his brother, not this one? His sister's not with us. Why is it? And they were feeling annoyed that this normal carpenter is trying to call himself God. So they were annoyed at him. And so they did not welcome him. They were astonished. Yes, they acknowledged that he knew what he was saying, but they did not welcome him to have to be Lord. And because they did not welcome him to be Lord, the Bible now says Jesus could not do much miracle there, except little things that he laid hands on people and something. And now said the prophet is not welcomed in his own country. So the people had the King of Kings there, but they did not welcome him into their life, so they could not experience what he had for them. So I'm going to continue today. The first thing I want us to note down, if you are writing, is this: the consciousness of God's presence in your life awakens everything about you. The consciousness of God's presence in your life awakens everything about you. It awakens your creativity. It awakens you to the point that you now know how filthy your heart is. The Bible talks about Isaiah, Prophet Isaiah, when he said in the year King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord. At that moment, he saw the presence of God. Then he now knew that, oh, I'm undone, I have unclean lips, I'm doing anything, I've done people of unclean. That's when he knew the presence of God. He was in the presence, the temple, and said the glory of God filled everywhere. So he knew the presence of God here. So this is that awoken him to the fact that he knew that I am not even worthy to stand here. So that's what I'm trying to explain, that the consciousness of God's presence in your life awakens everything about you. It awakens you to the point that it exposes the state of your heart. So when my father used to say something, that when you commit a sin, and you commit the sin so much that the thing, you don't even, your conscience does not prick you, you have locked out Jesus from your life. Because the fact that your conscience is pricking you means that the Holy Spirit is still there, still prompting. But when you feel it's normal, when that sin becomes normal, that means your conscience has been seared. You have seared your relationship between the Holy Spirit, so you are on your own at that moment. I also said that it awakens your creativity. Because when you are conscious of the Holy Spirit with you, it's like if you are cooking a food, I'm using cooking food because I like food anyways. you're cooking the food now and the ingredients are not there, the spices are not there, you're like, oh Lord, the Holy Spirit, I know you are here, you're my teacher and my help, show me how to do this. And the Holy Spirit will tell you how to put this, put that, put this, and the food will come out better than ever. I've experienced this many times. Like, I'll be cooking something and I'm like, what should I do, what should I do? Holy Spirit, you're like, Grace, wait 2 minutes time, put this one, put this one, put this one. And when I follow those instructions, that does not look like the normal sequence to cook that food, the food comes out better. So it awakens your creativity, the consciousness of His presence, when you know that you're carrying the person that can teach you everything, that can guide you. Even in exams or all, it can be your teacher. In business, he'll tell you, invest here, don't invest here, this and that, and he will just guide you. So your consciousness of His presence awakens everything about you, awakens your creativity, awakens. When I say creativity, it has to be different parts of life, not just cooking, different parts of life. Then the other one, why I use those two, because they are very key cardinal points. If your heart is so messed up, everything, that's where God resides now, so it's just so messed up. So when you know that God is in you, that awakens many things about you. The next thing I want us to write down, if you're writing, is this: welcoming the Holy Spirit, or welcome the presence of God. It means you are willing to walk it with Him and not question His instructions. It means you're willing to walk with Him and welcome Him and not question His instructions. That's I'm trying to explain what it means to welcome the presence of God into your life. It means you're willing to walk with Him, follow His instructions, and not question Him. You can say, I welcome somebody, I've welcomed you into this place, and you now, let's use a scenario now. A guest comes to your house, you now say, the person comes in, and the person now sits down, or wants to sit down. I say, no, don't sit down there. The person standing, no, don't sit down. This chair is for my listening. But you just welcome into your house, you expect me to stand? So you have not given Him complete access. Welcoming means you have welcomed Him, have access over everything, and He now tells you, okay, do this type of thing. I say, no, God, in my finances, God, you are God over my life, you are God over my marriage, but not in my finances. My finances is my business. You are not yet in the mindset of welcoming Him. I said, welcoming God's presence into your life means you are willing to walk with Him and not question His instructions. He tells you, give 90% of your income and take 10%. You will not say, God, but your Bible says 10%. Why are you telling 90%? You will obey Him wholly and fully. When God was telling Moses, go to this thing, Moses went to question God, but at the end of the day, he had to follow God's instruction. And the children of Israel, he brought out the children of Israel because he obeyed the whole thing. He was trying to say, God, I'm this one, God, I'm this one. At the end of the day, he knew that there's no point in arguing with God. What God wants, he will still do it. That's why it's God over itself. The next thing I wrote down about welcoming God's presence means being ready to accept whatever He brings into your life, even the ones you don't like. Being ready to accept whatever He brings into your life, even the ones you don't like. Like now, I've experienced this kind of thing. Me, I've experienced that. A guest will tell me they are coming to our house, and they get to the house, and they now come to that person I don't like. But because I've already welcomed the guest inside, I will just accept whoever I bring inside, because to all of them, I think. I remember when I was in school, there's this girl that came to my house. She now came with one weird looking guy. I did not like that, but I didn't want that person to know where I was living in. So I was just annoyed because I've already welcomed the guest. There's no way I could have said the girl come inside, you stay outside. So them came together, and I was irritated at it, but I've already welcomed them, so I had to allow them come inside. So that is a thing. You welcome Him, whether you like what God is telling you. If you go there, you fast 100 days, you fast the 100 days and not argue or question His decisions for your life. You know, Jesus, when Jesus came to earth to die for us, His mission was come and die for us. And God did not tell Him, this is how they're going to kill you. You shall know that you're going to die. And when God was telling Him, when He now started seeing how He was going to die, He was saying, God, this cup is too heavy for me, blah, 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 blah. He was crying and praying and praying. God did not save Him. At the end of the day, I said, not my will, but your will. That's welcoming God. I'm accepting whatever instruction you are bringing my way. I'm accepting that you are God. You will make the right choices for me. You will help me to do the right things. That's what welcoming Him is. The next thing I wrote down is, it is inviting Him into all areas of your life, even the places you think He wouldn't appear. That's when I was explaining about how consciousness of the Holy Spirit, when I'm cooking, I ask the Holy Spirit to help. Welcoming means you are inviting Him to every area, not just one part. Telling God, I know you are here, I'm conscious of your presence. So Father Lord, in this area, in my relationship, take over. In my food, in my cooking activity, I like food, take over. In my talking, take over. In my dressing, take over. Invite Him to, and when you invite Him to this day, you don't say that maybe normally just the same normal shirt and skirt that you have normally, or the gown you have normally. When you now ask Holy Spirit of God, I do this a lot, I'm like, Holy Spirit of God, dress me up when I have to go some important place. And the creativity just come out, like, I wear this, and my friend, my friend, ah, this shirt is looking very, very funny. I'm like, ah, don't, this shirt, I've had this shirt for like 5 years, but it was the Holy Spirit that did that thing. So it means inviting to all areas of your life, even the places you think is not important, it is important. He will come there and he will take over. That's what welcoming him is. So the next thing I want us to write down is this: when you welcome the presence of God into a place or your life, what happens when you welcome into a place of your life? Number one thing that happens is that he transforms not enough to more than enough. He transforms not enough to more than enough. Peter invited you, welcomed Jesus into his boat. Peter, he had toiled all night, he had been trying to catch the fish, he would not catch any fish. And Jesus now came the next morning, I want to use your boat. Peter said, oh, you're going to use it. He entered, Jesus not even call him again, come and push it. He told you that normal Nigerian that I am, like, ah, okay, what's your stress? I don't know you from anywhere. You came, I should give you boat, I give you boat. Now he said, come and push it into the water. Don't stress me, I've been working all night. But he went, he pushed it into the boat, into the water. And after that being that thing, what happened? Jesus turned that empty net to be a net breaking miracle material. So now, you want to experience net breaking miracles, you want more than enough in your life. Have you considered welcoming into your life? Have you considered welcoming into every area of your life? You're saying, ah, my business is not working, but are you inviting God into that business? You're saying your relationship is not working, are you inviting him and welcoming him to take over in that place? The areas of your life that are not working very well, ask yourself, have I welcomed the Holy Spirit into this? So now, if you've not welcomed the Holy Spirit into any area of your life, say this prayer after me. Lord, I'm sorry for not welcoming into my life. I ask that you come and take charge over every area of my life. I welcome you to be God over my life. I welcome you to be King over my life. I welcome you to take your place, to have your way in my life. Do what only you can do in my life, in the name of Jesus, for in Jesus' mighty name. So we're going to be ending this series here. Maybe for another time we can continue, but by tomorrow we're going to start another topic, and you won't want to miss it. It's still a continuation, but with a twist that you want to miss. Okay, I want to pray for us. Father, as we go out in our daily activities today, Lord Jesus, please only surprise us. Give us the grace to do the right things always. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for your mercies and your kindness. For in Jesus' name, I pray for that person watching this now that's feeling depressed and downcast. Lord Jesus, strengthen that individual. Give them more grace, more life. Give them more experiences with you. Let them know you, feel you, and see you in all they do in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. We give you all the glory, we give you all the honor. Thank you, God, for pleasantly surprising us and breaking the yoke of poverty or shame or sickness over our lives in the name of Jesus. Thank you for removing the cloak of darkness from us. Thank you for opening our heavens and releasing such blessings that there will not be room enough to contain it. Thank you for directing our path. Thank you for inhabiting our minds as beings in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Please, today, at least for 5 to 25 minutes, praise God. Praise God. He says he's glorious in holiness and fearful in praises. Praise him and see the wondrous things you do in your life. Remember, I am fresh fire, connecting the world with his love and his presence. Till we meet again, God bless you. Amen.
Are you worshiping with us for the first time? Congratulations. You are most welcome into this great gathering. This is no coincidence. We believe that your steps were ordered by God and He has a plan for you. You are now a candidate of God's revival. We are a generation called to worship the one true God. We do this in spirit and in truth, in kindness and in love, preaching and teaching the Word of God by the power of the Holy Spirit. Here, your mind will be renewed as we connect you to God's presence, and you are now transformed into a giant of a strange order. Welcome home.